All right, so what we're going to talk about today is how do you implement a queue with two stacks. So implementing a queue with stacks. So first off, let's establish what is a queue. A queue is not a data structure, it is an abstract data type. So what is an abstract data type? An abstract data type is just a certain policy we define, and we say for an item to be this type, it has to support these functionalities. What are those functionalities? So a queue has to support an enqueue function, and it has to support a dequeue function for it to be the queue abstract data type. So our job is to support this enqueue and dequeue functionality. It is to support first in, first out functionality, first in, first out, which is what a queue does, using stacks, which a stack is last in, first out in behavior. So there's a problem here, and this is going to be difficult at first. It doesn't make sense. How do you use stacks to implement a queue? So the key here is, if you got this in an interview and you've never seen it before, key is to see the mental barriers, see the mental blocks that you're going to face as you solve this. What problems does a stack give us when we try to get our first in, first out behavior with a queue? What problems do we face? And then once we have those problems, we can see how we solve them. So this is an approach you can take, and what we're gonna do is we're gonna walk through the thought process right now. Okay, so what are we going to do? We're going to walk through this, trying to implement a queue with just a single stack. So what we need to do is we need to see what problems does a stack give us when we're trying to implement a queue with it. So what do we need to do? We need to insert these items into the stack, and when we get a dequeue, we need to give them the item they want in a queue fashion. So you'll see what I mean. Let's walk through this. So let's insert one into the queue. And notice how I said queue. Yes, we're working with stacks, but our caller of this function, the outside person using this code, has no idea what we are doing. All they know is that this is a queue. So we're imagining this is a queue, but we're using stacks to implement our queue underneath. This is the underneath functionality. So they just called enqueue, we added one. So they call enqueue again, so we add two. So they call enqueue again, and they add three. And our outside caller, no idea. They do not know what is happening underneath. For all they know, we're using a normal queue, we're using an array underneath. They don't know we're using a stack. So this is what's happening underneath. And then they enqueue again with the item four. And then our caller enqueues again with the item five. So do you remember the order that our items were put into this queue? So let me write out the order they were put in. So if this were a normal array and we just implemented this as a normal queue without all of the stack craziness going on, we would have one is at the front of the queue, five is at the back of the queue. This is what our caller expects. Our caller expects this behavior. They see it from the outside as this is what's happening. This is what I want as a caller because you're saying you're supporting the queue abstract data type. So I expect this behavior. So how do we give them the behavior when we have a stack here? A stack is only going to give me access to five. Once I remove five, I only have access to four. Once I remove four, I only have access to three, only have access to two, and then only have access to one as we go down. So what is the item? If I call dequeue right now, if I remove from this queue, what item gets removed? One. And our caller expects a one, but we can't do that. We have a stack underneath, and this is barrier number one. We realize that the LIFO behavior of a stack clashes with the first in, first out behavior of a queue. So how do we give them one? The only way I can give them one is if I perform a linear time operation where I remove all these items so that I have access to the one. And it's linear time in respect to the amount of items in the stack because we have to remove some fractional component of the total items to get to one, right? So what we're going to do is let's remove five. We're trying to get down to one. Let's remove five. And then let's remove four. And remember, we're trying to get down to one. That's our goal right now. Let's remove three. And then let's remove two. And now I have access to the item that my caller wants. So I have access to this one. So you see, I can give my caller one now. But what is the problem? What is the problem? And this is where our ability to analyze runtime is very important. We see this is linear in runtime. And you would tell your interviewer this, yeah, I see this problem. This is linear in runtime. And we just had to remove all these elements, and now we have access to what we want. So yeah, give the caller the one, and then what should we do next? So we gave our caller the one, and I guess we just put all the items back. We only have one stack, so let's just return all the items to the stack. So I push two again, and again, remember, our caller has no idea we're doing this underneath. We're just doing this to support their expected behavior. The caller wants something from the outside. They have no idea this is going on underneath. Okay, so we reinserted all the items from the queue. So our caller asks us to dequeue again. So what we have to do is, our next item is two. That's the next item our caller expects. And our two is buried under the stack. And we see that we need to remove all the items. So I guess let's just remove all the items again. We need to get to this two. So let's remove five, four, and three. So remove five, remove the four, and remove the three. We can now give our caller the two. So give the caller their two. Okay, so that was linear time. So let's push all these items back. And again, this is a linear time operation to push the item back. And again, overall, we're going to stay linear in asymptotic complexity. The asymptotic nature of the dequeue is going to be linear. So what we're going to do is we're going to push all the items back. And
hey, Ben.
Yeah, yeah, what's up?
You did.
Oh, so
I think you should rewind.
That,
and show.
Yeah, yeah. Here, let's rewind. I think we missed something. Okay, so look at the stack. So you see that the items right next to the stack, if you look at what the caller expects to my right, you see that the items right there to the right of the stack are actually in the order we already want them. So when we do that removal to get to our one, what we're doing is we're actually putting all the other items into position that actually belong in the order that they belong. So why would we move all the items back when we just put them back into the order that we expect as a caller? So why don't we create a second stack? Because we'd stay within the parameters of the question. Let's make a second stack and see how things work out. Okay, so Ben just helped us out there and he helped us notice something. He helped us notice that on our right, when we popped from that stack, we had the items in the order we already wanted them. So why would we put them back into the wrong order when we put them back into the stack? So now we have one stack for pushing, we have one stack for popping items. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk through this again using this new optimization we have, and we're going to see how that changes things. And then we'll look at complexities and see why it changes things. So let's push one to the push stack. This stack is for enqueues. We push to this stack. And again, remember, this is underneath. The caller has no idea this is going on. So we push one. And then I push two, another enqueue from the caller. And then there's another enqueue from the caller. I push three. Okay, and now our caller says, I want the first item in the queue. I want to dequeue. So what does the queue actually look like? Okay, so this is what our caller sees from the outside. What the caller knows, all I know is I'm getting a 1, 2, and then a 3. But we have a 3, 2, and then a 1. So what we need to do is what we did before. We need to move all our items over, but this time, here's the difference. We have our other stack. This is the pop stack. So I'm going to try to pop off of the pop stack. It's empty. I know there's no items here to pop, and now I need to get my items from the stack that gets pushes, and I need to move them to the pop stack. And you'll notice how this helps us. So move the item, push the three onto the pop stack, and then push the two onto this stack, and then push the one onto this stack. And now we have what our caller wants. We have the one, but do you notice how we just improved? We improved by seeing now we have the two. If I give my caller the one, now I have the two. If a caller says, I want to dequeue again, they're going to get their two. If they say, I want to dequeue again, they're going to get their three. So let's get a push. The caller just called enqueue with the item four. So let's add that to the push stack. So we just added for, and what if the caller calls dequeue? Well, we're ready right here. We have this pop stack and we can pop this off for a dequeue. And the caller expects a 2. And again, let me add the 4 to what they expect. So we give them their 2. And then if they call dequeue again, that does not influence this stack. This stack is just receiving pushes and this stack is just handling pops or dequeues and enqueues. So we give them their 3 if they want a dequeue. And now they call enqueue, and then they call dequeue. And on dequeue, we look at the stack where we dequeue from, this pop stack, and we see that we don't have any items. We don't have any items ready to pop. So what we're going to do is, we're going to take from the push stack, and they expect a 4 and then a 5. So we need to move these items over here so that they're in the right order, and then we preserve that order and give the caller what they expect. So now we're ready to dequeue and we move the 5 off and the caller says dequeue again and we remove the 4 off. But what if the caller says, I'm gonna dequeue again? Well, look, we'll see this stack is empty. If this stack is empty, let's move items over from the push stack. The push stack is empty. If that is empty, I know my queue is empty. I cannot fill this with anything, and I cannot do anything here to flip items over. So both stacks are empty, so our queue is empty. So what you see here is actually a queue. For all the caller knows is that this is a queue. They don't know this is happening. Again, I need to stress this because this is a key concept in programming. It's abstraction. It is called abstraction, where we don't need to tell a caller how we're doing anything. We're doing what we're doing. We can optimize however we want for different types of situations, and the caller won't know. All the caller gets is what they expect. So now that we did a walkthrough, let's look at the time and space complexities. So what are our complexities? So if we declare the number of items in the queue as n, so we're going to use O of n space. That kind of seems obvious because at maximum, we're going to be holding the amount of items that we're given between the two stacks no matter what we do. But where it's more interesting is the time complexity of enqueue and dequeue stay constant. And this may be confusing until you realize or become familiar with something called amortized analysis. So the core idea behind amortized analysis is that we don't want to look at each operation's worst case. We want to look at the overarching algorithm's worst case. So yes, the worst case on dequeue is that we have an empty stack that we dequeue from, and we need to get items from the other stack. It's going to take linear time to move all those items over to the empty stack we dequeue from. So yes, the worst case on that operation is linear time. But the key to amortized analysis is how often does that operation happen? The key is that we realize that this is such a rare operation, or not really rare, but it does not happen enough that it needs to impact the way we bound the time. So the way we bound the time is on the very usual, very expected case that we're going to have items in our stack that we dequeue from. We expect that, and that is going to be the normal case, the very expected case. So it stays constant in time because we expect us not to have to do that worst case operation. Where you also see this is in the ArrayList class of Java, where the ArrayList needs to double in size to stay dynamic. This happens underneath, it keeps it constant in time because it's amortized. The way we analyze it is amortized. So that is the key to it. It's so we don't make an expensive operation make us bound very differently than if we made a more reasonable bounding based on what we really expect. So those are the time and space complexities. So if you like this video, hit the like button, subscribe to this channel. My goal is to build one of the world's largest software engineering resources for helping people study for software engineering interviews. I know I say this every video, but I feel like we get a little closer every single video that I do, but at the same time, I'm so far away from the goal and the vision that I see that I want to map out with these videos and this channel. So